Good evening. Welcome to the Monrovia City Council for April 17th, 2012. This evening, we will be opening in the honor of Griffith Cruz Ware Ramirez. He was born March 18th, 2012 to Georgina Ware Ramirez and Kevin Ramirez. And also, we're opening in the honor of Sierra Ruby Smith, born March 31st, 2012 to Kimberly and Brad Smith. Welcome to Monrovia, Griffin, and Sierra. Our invocation this morning will be, or this evening, will be given by Pastor Dorothy Scott and Pledge of Allegiance by Mayor Pro Tem Joe Garcia.
Thank you. Bow your heads, please. God, we are so excited about the possibilities of the future. Even as you have helped us with the challenges of the past, we thank you for new things. We thank you for new opportunities. We thank you for creative ideas. We thank you for new faces, new leadership. We thank you for the young people and their leadership of this city. And we ask you to bless this council meeting. May your wisdom flow through all of the words and decisions that are being made. Cover our city. We thank you. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Would you please join me in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have roll call, please?
Council members Adams.
Here.
Shevlin.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Garcia.
Here.
Mayor Lutz.
Present. Mr. Still, can you please give us a report of the closed session?
Thank you, Mayor. Prior to the meeting this evening at 6 p.m., the council, City Council and the successor agency to the Monrovia Redevelopment Agency met in a joint closed session. There were six items on the posted agenda. And the council took reports from staff and otherwise took no reportable action on any of those items.
Thank you. Now to start our presentations, we have a very special presentation that we delayed from our last council meeting, but it is just a very fitting honor. We know that we have the best fire department, police department, and city staff anywhere, but this has been confirmed. It's been confirmed in a big way, and I'm going to let Chief Donovan talk about one of our firefighters who received a very special honor.
Don't be shy. Thank you, Mayor Lutz, and members of the City Council, and thank you for this opportunity. It's a pleasure and really an honor for me to stand here with firefighter Mike Bailey. Many in these chambers know firefighter Bailey from his hard work and efforts. He's a dedicated professional. He is dedicated to the profession of firefighting, assisting our department in coordinating training for advancement through the ranks. He's been working with regional departments to assist them as well. He's also been instrumental in the city in disaster preparedness efforts, which really showed during our windstorm events. But beyond that, he's got an incredible influence that goes beyond the city in his volunteer efforts. And this story goes back about 2 years ago, and we had a firefighter at the time, Kent Struckus, whose daughter was soliciting some firefighters to help out with a project through AmeriCorps. And they were going to go down into South Central Los Angeles, and they were going to team together with Rebuild Together Los Angeles, which is a nationally recognized group that really helps to revitalize deprived and impoverished communities. And she got eight of our personnel to go down and help. And they did construction efforts, they did painting, they installed a handicap ramp for the church, and really did some wonderful things that reflected great on this city and on our department. And seven of those individuals came back and continued their fantastic efforts with our department. And one individual stayed behind and continued to work with this fantastic organization, and that's firefighter Mike Bailey. For the last 2 years, Mike has been quietly, he's a very, very humble man, doesn't seek accolades, but he's been quietly and steadfast in his support and volunteerism through Rebuild Together Los Angeles. And through those efforts for the last 2 years of true volunteerism, helping others, a desire to make a meaning and a difference in this world, Mike was rightfully and proudly acknowledged through that group with the Martin Luther King Jr. Volunteer Award, and in doing so received a letter of commendation from the President of the United States. This is a remarkable effort, and yet he was quiet and humble about it. He didn't tell many people about this. We had to do a little bit of digging and find out that Mike had gotten these awards, and that's the type of person he is. Firefighter Bailey, as I've mentioned, is a really hardworking, extremely proud individual. He's very committed to this community. Mayor, you know, through the work in Kiwanis, he's a proud member of Kiwanis and helps out with those efforts. Sorry, Mr. Adams, don't mean to start a conflict here, but
actually the mayor's in Rotary.
Oh, I'm sorry, my apologies. So
I'm married to the Kiwanian.
Yeah.
Very good.
There'll be a test later.
So, and I'll fail that one. Obviously, Firefighter Bailey's involved with this community and is quite worthy of this award. And so, like I mentioned, I'm proud to be standing here tonight with Firefighter Bailey. I want to thank him for his dedication and continued hard work and effort. And again, I think that this is a glaring example of the value of our employees, that we reach out and help anybody in need. And Mike Bailey is a great example of everything that we strive for. So congratulations, Mike.
Thank you.
Mr. Bailey, first, could you explain to us why you were keeping this such a secret? I read it in the paper from another community.
Well, for me, it was the fact that there were other firefighters involved, and I felt kind of, you know, that I was being singled out. I'm not really like to be singled out, so I told a couple of people at work, but. And there's three forms of communication: telephone, telegraph, and telefireman. So it got out. So.
Well, we are very thrilled that the news did get out, because you deserve all the accolades that this deserves. And we are very proud to tell you that we're proud of you. We're proud that you're part of our family. And congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. Our next recognition is for three women who have gone above and beyond. We are the Girl Scouts. Many of you know, in the last, I guess it was last month, celebrated their 100th anniversary. And when they celebrated their 100th anniversary, they singled out some of the Girl Scout leaders, not just in our area, but all throughout, I think all throughout the country, am I correct? But we are very honored to have not just one honoree, not two honorees. Three Monrovians have been singled out by the Girl Scouts of America as superior leaders. And we're thrilled today to have those three honorees here. We have certificates for you, and I'm going to call your name. And I'm going to read what's on your certificates, and it says the same thing except your name. And I'll call your name, and then we want to have a big photo for you. So, first off, the certificate reads, the Girl Scouts of Greater Los Angeles 2012 honoree, we applaud you and your dedication and devoted service as a volunteer for this great organization for your valuable contributions to the community and its youth. And we thank you for your leadership, Joyce Centinella, Joan Stingelmeyer, and Vicki Thrower. Please come up. We want to celebrate you.
Thank you. Vicky's our spokesperson.
I did not plan to say anything, but anytime I have a chance to talk on behalf of Girl Scouts, I will gladly stand up and do that. I am celebrating my 35th year as a Girl Scout, so not quite the whole 100, but through that time, I've been fortunate enough to work with fabulous leaders and women like this, and to see girls come up from kindergarten. These girls in front don't want to be singled out, but we've known them since kindergarten. They're graduating this year with the highest girl award in Girl Scouts, called the Gold Award, and they both are going to Sonoma State in the nursing program. And we know that a large part of that is their training through Girl Scouts and the experiences that they've had traveling, serving, and having many different experiences with the fabulous leaders behind me. So, thank you so much, Mayor Lutz and City Council. We appreciate any time that we get to say a positive word about Girl Scouts. Thank you.
Congratulations. And last week, was it just last week? My goodness. We held our annual spring egg hunt event, and it was spectacular. So I'm going to bring Lisa Hansberg to the front to talk about the event and tell us all about the sponsors, because nothing happens without the sponsors.
That is correct, Mayor. Fix this here. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Tonight, I have the pleasure of assisting City Council in recognizing the sponsors of the 2012 Spring Egg Hunt event. The Spring Egg Hunt and Healthy Kids Day activities took place on Saturday, April 7th, from 10 to 1 p.m. in Recreation Park. 2,703 children participated in one of the 11 egg hunts that day.
Wow.
Each event reached, the event participation reached 3,500 as families enjoyed many activities, including carnival games, arts and crafts, demonstrations, along with teen, toddler, and family activities. The spring event would not be possible without the generous contributions from this year's sponsors. At this time, I'd like the council to come forward and help me recognize the sponsors this year. Oh. Well, there's a lot of little guys. First up, I'd like to bring up Yanher Zalada and Greg Mutart from Champions Karate. Next, I'd like to bring up Connie Anderson of Turner and Stevens Live Oak Memorial Park. Thank you. then Patrick Euler of Post Alarm Systems. And then next, Peter Hoffman of Sierra Auto Cars. Oh, I'm sorry. Next, I'd like to bring up Diane Balsamo and Nikki Felix of PNC Mortgage. And next, Andrea Bunsman of Huntington Veterinary Hospital. Hopefully you're here. Okay, and last but not least, I really hope our VIP sponsor is here, Ron Cooperstein of Monrovia Memorial Hospital. They said they were going to be here. That's it, then. Okay. On behalf of the Department of Community Services, thank you to all of our sponsors for making this community event a great success. Thank you.
It was quite a successful event. Just the 2,000 young children in the 1 egg hunt, that had to have been something. I don't think I saw that one. It seemed to me that there were about 4,000 to 5,000 people throughout the park that day. It was phenomenal. And it is another example of the partnerships that happen in our community. This is a partnership of all of the sponsors, the city, and the YMCA. And again, these things don't happen overnight. There were other partnerships. I think Kiwanis was part of it, and the Rotary Club was part of it, and Monrovia Reads, handing out books to children. Another pure Monrovia success story. Thank you to everybody involved in that. Congratulations. And next is our student government liaison report with Kevin Greenwood.
Okay, thank you. I will start off this evening with the events, and then I will end with our very long list. It's here, double-sided, where all of our Wildcats are going this year, as I was asked.
Okay.
All right, so first things first, our Harlem Wizards, the Harlem Wizards, which is a Globetrotter-like team, will be visiting this Saturday at 7 o'clock in the Event Center, and they'll be taking on the MUSD Staffelty All-Stars, which will include several teachers from the high school as well as some of our some of the others from the other schools as well. And I highly recommend going. It's a lot of fun because I'm sure some of you are aware Mr. Jackson did play college basketball, and it's a whole different side of him when he's out there knocking people over and shooting over people, and it's really fun to watch.
7 o'clock.
Yeah, 7 o'clock, yes.
And tickets are still available.
Yes. Yeah. And our spring rally will be this Thursday during lunch. So it's come out and get ready for our CST testing, which is next week. The Robber Bridegroom, which is our musical, which I'm in, will take, have me not be here on our next meeting. And you guys are our parent night, and we'll be performing at 7 o'clock for the public through Wednesday through Saturday. So come out and see Mr. Siegel's last production. And for those two who were worried about not wearing the suit tonight, I'll be plenty dressed up for that, I assure you. Our graduation is less than 51 days away, and our announcements will be delivered on the 26th. Softball team won the Northview Tournament, which is a very large tournament in this area, so we're very proud of them with that, this effort, and with their first-year coach. Our Dollars for Davian fundraiser is coming up, well, is going on right now, and this is in honor of Davian Graham, who is a former Wildcat, who was a victim of gang violence. Fortunately, he was not killed because of it, but he was paralyzed. And this scholarship was in his name to help anyone who, the first couple years it went directly to him, but now it is for any senior who writes an essay about how gang violence has impacted their lives. And at the conclusion of the fundraiser, the essay will open up, and then we will award that essay at the end of the school year. Our National Day of Silence is this Friday, which is an effort where students can sign up to remain silent that day in awareness of the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender students who have committed suicide across the country because of bullying and harassment that they face on a daily basis. Our elections for next year's ASB and the class councils will be happening very shortly. And we're very proud of our small business management class, and they won the regional championships and are going to Kansas City for the finals as part of Skills USA. And our prom and grad night tickets are going very quickly, so be sure to buy them as soon as you can. And we're offering a special this year, where if you purchase your grad night tickets and your senior breakfast tickets, this is for seniors, you get the senior breakfast for only $5. And now I will read our very long list of where everyone is going. So, Kevin Romero is going to UC Santa Barbara. Levi Helm is attending CSU Channel Islands. Valerie Garcia will also be attending CSU Channel Islands. Sean Hansen will be attending CSU Monterey Bay. Michelle Parker will be attending San Francisco State. Jocelyn Torres will be attending Weber State. Jade Banks will be attending the University of St. Francis. Alexis Martinez will be attending Cal State University, Los Angeles. Rebecca Rangel will be attending Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. And then we have a lot of people going to this school. I have Gabriel Duran, Samantha Maggio, Nicole Stiglmeyer, Jordan Loragia, Chris Luring, and Priscilla Saldona will all be attending Sonoma State University. Jeanette Caron will be attending Oregon, University of Oregon. Lisa Carlson will be attending BYU-Idaho. Giselle Moreau will be attending Stanford University. Brad Felty will be attending University of Utah. Paula Martinez will be attending Weber State. Ariel Johnson will be attending Louisiana State University. Alana Karitsky will be attending Brandeis University. Stephanie Garcia will be attending University of California, Davis. Lauren Jones will be attending California State University, Northridge. And Crystal Gaeta and Nicole Wells will be attending University of California, Los Angeles, or UCLA. I'm saying them all fancy for some reason. And we have Jenny Dolores, Sydney Loft, and myself will be attending Cal State University, Fullerton. Yay. And that is all for right now. And there will be a few more coming up, but this is the most of the sign on the line that has occurred.
This is fantastic. Let's give them all a round of applause. You tell us you will not be at our next council meeting because
I will not be there. We are having our, that will be our parent night for our parents to come, and it's the one night where they're allowed to run around and take pictures. And then Wednesday night, we open up for the general public, and you write your tickets at the door, and closing night, because it is Mr. Siegel's last performance at the high school, it'll be very full. There's a lot of alumni, and everyone will be in attendance. I really hope that everyone can come out. Even on Wednesday through Friday, it'll be the same cast and everything, so the show will be just as good. So even if you're afraid of crowds last night, you can come out any of the other nights, and it'll be a fun time no matter when you come, and I hope everyone can come.
Great. Thank you for a very informative report. Thank you. Okay, moving on to the order of business. Mr. Alvarado, do we have any change of order of business?
No, ma'am. No changes order of business.
Okay, thank you. Consent calendar.
Move approval.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
So moved. And our next item is the public input. This is the time when anybody can speak to this council on any item which is not on the agenda. All you need to do is fill out a speaker card, and our city clerk will call your name. Ms. Atkins, do we have any speakers?
Yes, we do. Our first speaker is Mark Still.
Good evening, Mayor Letts, City Council persons. My name is Mark Still. I'm with Monrovia Historical Museum, and I wanted to take a few minutes and tell you about the massive number of events we have in May. Starting with May 5th and 6th, we'll be doing our United States Military Living History Encampment. We'll be having reenactors and soldiers, current soldiers, at the museum. There'll be music and food. The children should be coming out. They'll have a chance to talk to Mr. Lincoln. On May 13th is our Mother's Day event in conjunction with Monrovia Historic Preservation Group. Tickets for that home tour, by the way, can be purchased at the museum in the morning of the tour. The museum itself will be open from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. There'll be special guests and presenters. We're also introducing a new set of recipes from historic Monrovia, so the ladies should like that. On May 20th, we're going to be trying again at our community's event. It was scheduled for March 25th and was rained out, so it was rescheduled for May 20th. It's called Many Cultures, One Family, and it's a time we get together to celebrate the communities here in Monrovia. The communities that are taking part this year are our Black community, our Latino community, Asian community, and for the first time ever, the Gabrieleno community is going to take part. The Gabrielenos, of course, are the Native Americans that lived here before the Europeans arrived, and they're going to be taking part. It should be quite a bit of fun. School kids will be taking part as well. They'll be dressing as historic figures and speaking some lines about each of the historic figures from Southern California into Monrovia. And we'll have food and music. Ballet Folklorico will be here. Special storytellers. And some of the historic churches of Monrovia will be represented by the pastors who will speak about the history of those churches. And that's from 1 to 4 on May 20th. The museum is at 742 East Lemon Avenue on the north side of Recreation Park. And this is your museum, Monrovia. Come out, have some fun, and see what's happening at the museum. Thank you. Yes?
On the Saturday, May 5th and 6th, what time are the...
We'll be opening at 10 a.m. and closing at 5, both days.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Michael Fiore.
Thank you, Mayor and City Council. I'd like to first off thank all of our friends for coming out and supporting us today. And thank you, Mayor and Council, for letting me speak. Our world is going greener while our economy is in the red. We hear this from our government, we read this in our papers, and we see it on the news every day. We are experiencing this directly with our families and right here in our community. Storefronts are empty on Myrtle Avenue, but how cool is it that our little town of Monrovia has its own green team? So we know things can change, and that is good. My name is Michael Thomas Fiore. I was born and raised here in Monrovia and still call it home today. Not going anywhere. I am a proud father of three divine children, ages 16 months, 15 years, and 20 years old. So as you know, I've seen lots of change. My 15-year-old's driving now, which is driving me crazy. But again, change is good. About a year ago, my lovely wife Shana came up to me with one of her brilliant ideas and said, "I've got a great idea. I all the time I go and search the internet and try to find really cool green stuff for Julian, toys and products. I take Julian's outgrown clothes to a place that's 30, 45 minutes away to trade them in for new clothes at an affordable price. I bet other moms in our community are doing the same thing. So what if my new mommy dream was to open an eco-friendly children's boutique, and we can call it Diggin' for Daisies. I can share these amazing green products and toys that I've been finding and create a place for moms and dads and their kids' outgrown clothes and recycle them. Great for the environment and great for the pocketbook. And I said to her, go, honey, go. And just over a month ago, I'm proud to say we opened Diggin' for Daisies right here in our town of Monrovia. It's been really great. The community has welcomed us with open arms. We've turned people on to a greener way of thinking. And the upcycle clothing program is a hit, especially in this economy. Moms are so happy that they no longer have to go outside of our community to recycle their children's clothes. Diggin' for Daisies ties perfectly with Monrovia's green credo, promoting and encouraging the reuse of resources instead of creating more waste. We didn't even know how much in line we were with the city's green team. In 2010, there was a sustainability fair. They had a fashion show that featured gently used clothes. And we hear that the city's employees also did a clothing exchange. So we know that the city really understands and really gets what we're trying to do here. And the moms and dads in the community are really turning up. They're turning it on to other families in the area. Mothers groups are rallying up behind us, sharing the information with even more people in more communities. Because of our store's green concept, we are attaching like-minded people to come and shop in our town. So Monrovia's Greens Credo is reaching even further. Now, the reason we are here before you is because for all the green ideas Monrovia is pursuing, the city's municipal codes have some issues about parents bringing pre-loved children's clothing in for our upcycle program because our dress is on Myrtle Avenue. We completely understand protecting the image of our little town and Myrtle Avenue in particular. We want that too. We'd like to suggest for your consideration is a provision to the existing code that designates an alternate route for drop-offs on specific days by appointment only. While our store is on Myrtle Avenue, we are not a storefront on Myrtle Avenue. We are three doors down. We're in between Bella Sara and Gem City Jewelers, and we're down right next to Action Foot Sports. So we're really kind of off the beaten path. We're not a storefront on Myrtle. Wouldn't it be great to promote the city's principles in the heart of our community, showing the benefit of the sustainability? This is something that our community and parents are deeply supporting. You can see this by our petition, which I have here. We have over 200 names and signatures of people that have supported this and really want to be able to have access to affordable clothing for kids, mind you. Please keep in mind while you're considering our request that 80% of our store is new items such as green toys, children's books, teaching our kids to be environmentally conscious and in a fun way, cloth diapers, and other eco-friendly products. We are a boutique store. We are not a thrift store. Also, again, our store is not on Myrtle. Yes, we are asking you guys to think big and think green. We are asking for a little change in the existing codes that were made over 15 years ago. We are asking you to look forward, to be innovative, to be now. We are inspiring a change for the better, and we believe change is good. And for a quick shameless plug, Sunday is Earth Day. If you want to come to our store, we're giving away free daisies that kids can come in, parents can come in, plant a daisy, and take it home. And we're supporting the community and its green credo. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Pam Fitzpatrick.
So, did you know that April 29th is actually May 5th? Anybody here to talk about Cinco de Mayo? Just me. Okay, I'm here representing the Old Town Merchants. And the first thing I want to tell you about is April 29th, Sunday, from noon to 9 in the evening. You know, last year, the Cinco de Mayo Association had their first kind of trial, Cinco de Mayo, on Colorado. It was packed, and it was so packed that it was crowded, and everyone said, Myrtle Avenue, this is what it belongs on. So April 29th, Sunday, from noon to 9 p.m., Delgado Brothers, Ballet Folklorico, names I can't pronounce, wonderful performers, booths on the street, Old Town Merchants being open, neat things going on in the stores. It's Cinco de Mayo on April 29th. You can live with that, right? Mm-hmm. It's cool, right? And then going on into May. not to neglect Mother's Day, but Mother's Day we always have by in Old Town. But then May 19th, come back for the whole day. Start at 7 o'clock and sign up on the city's website and race from the fountain in Library Park to the falls and come back. Take a breather, get a peanut butter sandwich from Quota, breathe, and then go into Old Town, have breakfast, and then the parade starts at 10 o'clock. It's going to be really cool. We have great, Julie Gentile is a dignitary in the parade, and then somebody else too, right? I'm not sure, I kind of lost it. But it's going to be a great parade. It's one neighborhood for all is the theme. And that's what we're all about. So parade starts at 7 o'clock, I mean at 10 o'clock, and from then on until the line dancing after the park, I mean after the concert in the park, we're going to be going. We have crafts on the street in Old Town. We have jugglers. We have stilt walkers. We have barbershop quartet. We have strolling fiddlers. We have lots of things going on up at the park. Kiwanis is sponsoring a cupcake contest. Is this the best or what? What birthday is this?
126.
126th? Amazing. We look younger than that. It's going to be a wonderful day. So all the way through April and May, it's Old Town. Come and see us. Thank you.
Thank you. There are no other speaker cards. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this council about any item that is not on the agenda? Yes, Mr. King.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council, City Staff. My name is Chuck Heen. I'm here on behalf of our American Legion Post here in Monrovia, Post 44. And there's two things that are coming up on the calendar in the month of May that I'd just like to bring to everyone's attention. One is obviously Memorial Day, which will be on Monday, May 28th, and that'll be down at Live Oak Park down on Duarte Road here in Monrovia. Then also, Supervisor Mike Antonovich is having his honoring our veterans and their families, past, present, and future, and that's going to be held on Saturday, May 26th. From 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. over at County Park in Arcadia on Santa Anita and Huntington. And that will be, it's free admission, it's open to the public, it's open primarily for the veterans and veterans' families to give them a lot of good information. There's going to be skydivers, weather permitting, there'll be skydivers, a flyover by World War II fighter planes, food booth, music, there'll be free manicures and haircuts for veterans. Immunizations, health screenings, employment information from WorkSource through the county. Foothill Transit is also sponsoring this with this. Legal information for veterans. And there'll be a special tribute for the armed forces, which will be held at 11:30 a.m. on that day. It's going to take place rain or shine. And we usually have around 5,000 people that show up from all over the county and outside of LA County, actually. But we just want to invite veterans, their families, the public, everyone's welcome to come to that. And we just would like to really encourage you to come and get that. And if you have any issues with the VA system, it's a good place to come and try and contact people at the VA there also. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak to this council about an item which is not on our agenda? Seeing and hearing none, we will close the public input part. And Mr. Fiore, I want to thank you for speaking to us this evening and ask that you speak with Steve Sizemore, our Director of Community Development. He is right outside the door, and he'll be working with you.
Thank you.
Okay, we will now move on to the reports of City Council members, and I will start with Council Member Adams.
Thank you. I just really have one announcement to make. Friday, May 18th will be the annual Don Montgomery Memorial Golf Tournament. Once again, in Azusa Greens. This raises money for the Mary B. Thorne Club at the high school for scholarships as well as youth programs at the YMCA. I think they're pretty close to selling out, but they always take donations and there's always room for dinner. and I hope to see everyone there. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Spicer.
I have no report, Mayor.
Mayor Pro Tem Garcia.
Thank you. excuse me. 2 weeks ago, I mentioned to you that I was going to speak regarding some of the public art projects that we have been doing in town. And so at this time, I'm going to update you with that. I'm going to ask our management analyst, Ann Bell, if he could come up and kind of give us a summary on what's been going on with our public art in town.
Thank you, Mayor, City Council. Yes, we've been quite active here in the Art in Public Places program, so I'm glad Mayor Pro Tem Garcia asked me to come tonight because we work very closely on this. What we've been doing here, and you see one example of a recent example of the electrical boxes. This is something that staff, together with the Art in Public Places committee, felt that would reach out to the community and beautify some of the areas that were had graffiti on them or needed some help there in high traffic areas. So this one is on the corner of Magnolia. That's why the Magnolia flower. And Huntington Drive, right on the corner, on the northeast corner. And these have been really successful. And one of the ideas that why this came up was, as we talked about, some of the graffiti, the problems that we've had in town. And we'll go to the next one here. This is the corner by the Wells Fargo at Myrtle and Colorado. You see the one on the left there had been tagged multiple times, and through fading and weathering and things like that. This was the first electrical box that we got approval to move forward on, and you see the end result there on the right. We'll go to the next one. This is in Library Park. We felt, you know, when the brand new library came in and the beautiful park and everything was restored, we felt, why not move this type of project into Library Park? So you see these on the north side on Palm, right across from the community center, and you turn the ones on the left and to the ones on the right with the chess pieces. And if the folks at home haven't seen this or don't know, this the reason the chess pieces were chosen is because we have the chess tables right there, just to the south of those two boxes. So we tried to keep the themes tied into their location or some common theme with something around them. So that's why the chess piece is there. And then here's another example. You see the one just very plain. A lot of things we'd been having problems with in the Old Town area were the postal stickers. The youth were taking these and sticking them on these boxes, and they're very hard for our public works staff and our graffiti removal staff that we hire to get those off. And they bring down the environment of the Old Town. So we turned this one into a nice sunflower scene that you see on the right there. Now, in moving forward with this type of project, you'll see there the bullet points on the bottom are the locations where staff has identified some more boxes in high traffic area. We began this project in Old Town along Myrtle Avenue because it is such a beautiful old town that we have here, and the foot traffic, and we started receiving a lot of compliments on how those boxes turned out. So the staff, along with the committee, decided that we wanted to move forward with this, and then also down into Foothill and Huntington as we move forward. So you'll see the one that is completed there at Magnolia. We actually just completed the one on the corner of Shamrock and Foothill just today. So if you haven't seen that, if you're watching at home and you're driving by, please take note of that. That's on the northwest corner there. And then you'll see some others that are scheduled to be painted. Various themes. And if anyone has ideas, this is another thing that we've done. Please call. You can contact Diane Delmatoff at 626-303-6600. And we're open to ideas on themes for these. But here you'll notice some of the themes for the boxes that are scheduled to be painted. And then another component of the Art in Public Places project is twofold. You have the Samson the Bear project that you'll probably remember from Monrovia Days last year. There were seven bears that were paraded through the Monrovia Day Parade, and then there were designated locations where these bears would be put out. These two in particular are again, in Old Town, you'll notice the one on the left kind of an artist theme, which ties in nicely, right across from the Krikorian Theater there at the crosswalk. And then the one just below is kind of the tourist theme, and that is in front of T. Phillips there on the corner of Myrtle and Colorado. So please stop by and see those. Another project that we move forward with, the Art Committee approved this one here, this little archway, last year, and that is the Lemon Court Archway. This is something that ties in with, you'll see in that lower box, it's not too big, but a mural that we are trying to do, and we have reached out to the Krikorian Theater. If you see, I don't know if you can see it, but in the background there's a large wall along the Krikorian, and we are trying to highlight that area in the back there, and it's used for special events, and it is an area where people can cut through to Myrtle or from Myrtle to Lemon Avenue. That's right down the street here from City Hall. So that sign is there. It was kind of worn out. There were some bad soil in there and some dead bushes at the top. And so those were replaced with lights that kind of uplight this. And then there are also some lights that are affixed to that gate there that uplight the Lemon Court sign. So a real good project that the committee brought forward, and we had success with that. And we are looking to bring a mural in that area forward in the next few months. And here's another project as I wrap up that is proposed that the committee looked at, and we're getting pricing on this. And this is, if you'll notice, this is on the corner of Primrose and Lime Avenue, and this is a book theme. And we thought, as staff in the committee, moving forward right there by the playground, that we would go with the book theme and uplight it. And it's a really good project that the committee was approving of. The only deal was looking at the funding and the concrete slab. The committee had come back with recommendations where the stairs are deep enough where parents can sit there with their kids, or parents can sit there and watch their kids play in the playground. So this is a project that is coming forward in the future that will be a really large piece on that corner. It's a high visibility corner there on Primrose and Lime. And so we're real, real happy with this, and we're moving forward this and with some other mural projects. So we are very active. We are looking for more projects coming up, and we'll bring a report back to you probably about 6 months or so. So.
Thank you, Dan. You know, one of the things that I want to point out here, and I think I can comfortably speak on behalf of all of my colleagues here, how proud we are of our Art in Public Places program. This is truly different projects that contribute and really kind of act as validation that this community truly appreciates art in their community, and they're different types of projects that really don't have to cost much. I think it kind of validates that, but that really kind of enhances the sense of place that Monrovia has, and each little thing is kind of an additional testament to that, and I'm real proud of not only the staff for continuing to move forward and bringing us different types of projects and artists and what have you. I feel really proud of working with this Art and Public Places Committee here and helping us to disseminate the funds that come from this program. And I'm hoping as we continue to start to work towards enhancing our economic development in town again, that we will continue to be bringing forward some future projects here that the whole community can enjoy. So thank you, Dan, for bringing this forward to us. And again, just wanted to update the council on what a great job this committee is doing on this.
Thank you, Mr. Garcia. Thank you first for bringing this item before us, because I think it's important that we update and everybody knows what's going on. But more importantly, I want to thank you because you brought this program to our city. It was your vision that brought this, and it is something that has, as you said, it enhances our entire community.
Thank you, Mayor.
So we are very appreciative of your foresight and your vision on that.
Thank you.
So thank you. Councilmember Shevlin.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. yes, April is Keeping America Beautiful Month. And keeping in line, we talk about the art in public places. Back in October for Make a Difference Day, I planted some iris out in the front of the City Hall. And they're finally blooming. So if you have a chance, stop by and look at the beautiful iris blooming in the front of City Hall. I'm very excited. And hopefully next year there'll even be more. And talking about keeping Monrovia beautiful, I am working with staff and with Athens, and hopefully soon we'll be able to bring forward a special cleanup day in Monrovia, to pick up a lot of trash and other things that make us a little less beautiful, so we can be nice and clean and pretty. And you'll be hearing more about that. I did want to bring your attention again to several items. There's a wealth of information on the city's website, and we were talking about the theme of Monrovia Day, Monrovia One Neighborhood for Everyone. And in honor of that theme, the Neighborhood Services Division is hosting a Neighborhood Story Project. Submit a story on a neighborhood project, a cool feature, or a way that you get together. The contest winner will receive $100 in groceries for their next neighborhood get-together. Deadline to submit is April 25th, and there is a link on our website, so please check that out. Smart Gardening Workshop is coming up this Saturday, April 21st, and that's at 9:30 a.m. in Recreation Park. And attendees will get information about gardening, composting, and recycling, so please check that out. And also, again, positions are open on Monrovia boards and commissions. Applications are available from the office of the city clerk and city hall. And they can also be found online. And there's also a very special informational meeting for interested parties. It's scheduled for 5:30 p.m. Monday, April 23rd, this coming Monday. And you can call 932-5598. To attend, to make a reservation or for any questions, but keep that in mind for all of those that are interested in any of our open board or commission positions. And I wanted to also bring to your attention, Mayor was talking about Monrovia Reads, and Monrovia Reads tries very hard to be a very strong partner in the community, and it also assists the Monrovia Reads and Plays program through the community services to make that program work. The group also supports tutoring programs, book distributions, things like that. But the way we make our money are through fundraisers, and there is one coming up Monday, May 7th from 5 to 7:30 p.m. poolside at the Double Tree Hotel on Huntington Drive. It's a Mexican appetizer buffet. No host bar tickets. It's a very affordable fundraiser. It's $25 a person. There are opportunity drawing tickets, $5 each for a weekend stay for two nights, and including breakfast each morning and a dinner worth $100 and complimentary bottle of champagne, a sort of gift basket. So please come out and support Monrovia Reads. Again, that's Monday, May 7th from 5 to 7:30 p.m. at the Doubletree. And I just wanted to very quickly highlight a couple of the other items that will be happening on Monrovia Days. The Friends of the Monrovia Public Library will be having a huge sale that day as well. So please come out and support our Friends of the Library that raise lots of money that goes back into the library and programming. So come out and buy some books that day. Open to the general public from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. The sale will feature the famous and now extended $2 a bag sale. So come on, that's on Monrovia Day, Saturday in Library Park. And also the Theater Americana's USO show. And that's sponsored by the Monrovia League. And join us for an old-fashioned, patriotic, and heartwarming tribute to our servicemen and women, past, present, and future, who defend our freedoms at home and abroad. Theater Americana's USO show weaves historical narration through musical numbers to take audiences on a nostalgic journey. This special library program is a proud part of Monrovia Day activities and celebration. Don't miss it. It will be Saturday, May 19th, from 2 to 3 p.m.
in the Library Park band shell, and that is free. So come out, and we've got lots and lots of events. And I hear there's also, are we still doing that dunk tank thing? We're still doing the dunk tank thing, too.
So, we're all looking forward to that.
Yes, 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 yes. And that's all I have this evening. Thank you.
For my report at the last council meeting, I told you that I would be attending a U.S. Conference of Mayors Water Council meeting in Indiana, and in fact I did. And it was a really great jam-packed 2 days full of talking about water, water supply, water quality, sewer systems, water, the gamut on water. But what's really great about these meetings is it brings forward people from US EPA at the highest levels. It brought somebody from United States Bureau of Reclamation who came and spoke to us and gave a lot of us mayors new ideas and new concepts that we can put in place, and some new rules and policies that US EPA is putting in place that actually will be beneficial to our community. So I'm very excited. I'm meeting with staff later in this week to give them some of the information that I received, and it continues to be a very worthwhile meeting on a regular basis because it gives us so much information and so many contacts with the people who make the decisions at mostly at US EPA. Continuing on the water theme, later in the week on Friday when I returned, I was honored to attend the Upper San Gabriel Valley Municipal Water District, who happens to have their offices here in the city of Monrovia. They were hosting a recycling program that they have completed in West Covina at their Big League of Dreams Park. And some of you may know where that is. It used to be a landfill, BKK landfill. It is now a beautiful park. But what the city of West Covina did when their vision to build this park, and it's a partnership with the Big League of Dreams, they envisioned this not just being a park, but being a recycled water center. And they partnered with the Upper San Gabriel Water District, who received a $5 million grant, then received a $23.6 million zero interest loan from the State Water Board. And together, using money as well from the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation, they put together a $33.5 million recycling program that they are turning the switch on as of Friday. It's a wonderful idea. They're going to be able to water all of those fields with recycled water. It's the future of our country. It's the future. And it was so important at this event that we were honored to have two sitting Congress members, Congressmember Judy Chu and Congressmember Grace Napolitano, who had worked to help get the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation to assist in this project. Congressman Chu told us about a bill that she is working on right now that is a very important bill. Most of you know that a lot of the water that San Gabriel Valley uses for drinking water is groundwater. We have aquifers, large aquifers underneath San Gabriel Valley. But we are also the largest Superfund site in the country, which means some of that groundwater is contaminated. And it's a Superfund. The federal government is supposed to help us clean it up. The bill that gave the money for the Superfund is sunsetting. And Congressman Chu has a bill to extend that sunset, to reinstall it. But it's meeting with a lot of resistance right now in Congress, because a lot of members of Congress see this as an earmark. It is just to continue with the funding that was promised to this community and to this region decades ago. Yet she's finding some roadblocks, and she and Congressmember Napolitano are working very hard to do that, because if we can't clean up these Superfund sites with the money that was promised us by the federal government, you know who's going to have to pay to clean it up? You and I. We need to, if you feel so inclined, to write a Congress member and encourage them to finalize, to agree to have this bill sunset pushed back so that the funding can continue to flow. They've done great work and they need more time to get more of this cleaned up. And then I want to update you on a project that is a project that the San Gabriel Valley Council of Government started a few years ago in partnership with the California Product Stewardship Council. And Ron has a quick little PowerPoint. This project is a battery recycling project, and they came before us a few months ago and kind of gave us an update where you can take your used batteries to some locations in Monrovia, and actually all over San Gabriel Valley, but we have three locations here in Monrovia. And I'm pleased to say that we have done a tremendous job. In fact, this story in San Gabriel Valley has caught on nationwide. And the next slide is a slide from Times Square in New York City. And who is that photo of? I believe that is Council Member Shevlin giving her batteries.
Didn't know I was in New York.
To Heidi Sanborn from the director, who is the director from Product Stewardship Council.
Yeah, I had a big envelope.
Council Member Shevlin was in Times Square, and that apparently will stay up for another week in Times Square, and it is there right now. That's pretty awesome, isn't it?
For you.
Congratulations. I have a smaller photo for you to take of that. But we heard about this, and I thought we have to celebrate Council Member Shevlin. So we have taken, San Gabriel Valley has taken almost 8,000 pounds of batteries for recycling. That means they're not in our landfills. They're not contaminating our landfills. They're being recycled, and it is easy to do. All you have to do is take your batteries to one of these three locations here in Monrovia: the Army Navy Surplus Store in Old Town, Digital Camera Repair, which is where the photograph was taken of Council Member Shevlin, or the Dollmakers Catawampus. Bring your bags full of batteries, and they will take them off your hands for free. And then they send them in to the product stewardship people who recycle them. It's a great program, costs you nothing, and it helps keep batteries out of landfills. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And that ends my report this evening. Thanks, Ron. Our next item is a very exciting item for us. This is our city attorney, Craig Steele, will talk to us about our city manager employment agreement.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. As you know, at the last meeting, we announced that the city council had extended an offer to Lori Lyle to become the city's new city manager, and you directed us to go off and complete an employment contract for the council to consider at this evening's meeting, and we have done so, and that contract is before you. It is a proposed 3-year employment contract. And the annual salary of the city manager would start at $185,000 per year, subject to one annual increase at the discretion of the city council following performance evaluations. The 3-year contract, like most city manager agreements, is subject to being terminated at any time on 30 days' notice by the city council. If it was to be terminated, what we call without cause, for no reason, which is the council's option, Ms. Lyle would be entitled to a 9-month severance package. If the contract was terminated with cause for some reason, there would be no severance benefit payable. City manager would be eligible for an annual performance bonus of up to 5% at the sole discretion of the city council, again based on the annual performance evaluation. The supplemental benefits are the same as are provided to the other management employees of the city in terms of health insurance and those items. She would receive a car allowance of $450 per month for the business use of her personal automobile. I want to correct one sentence in the staff report, which is written with a typo in it, and it doesn't make any sense. And it's the second sentence of the fiscal impact paragraph. It says the compensation package offered is at a lower salary than was paid to the previous city manager. The salary is not lower than what was paid to this previous city manager, but the compensation package itself is lower than the compensation that was paid to the previous city manager, in that Ms. Lau will be paying the full portion of the employee contribution to the PERS retirement system, which is a significant amount of money that the prior city manager was not paying. The city paid on his behalf. So the total compensation package is less than the compensation package for the prior city manager by about 2.5% or thereabouts. Ms. Lyle has signed the contract, so we have her signed contract in-house, if you will, and it's waiting only for City Council's approval and the mayor's execution. So staff would recommend that the council approve the agreement, authorize the mayor to sign it on behalf of the city, and that concludes my report. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions of Mr. Steele?
No? I'll move approval.
I'll second that.
Okay. Before we vote, I want to first thank Ms. Lyle for what I consider to be a wonderful negotiation period that went very smooth. And I want to acknowledge something Mr. Steele said and make sure that everybody really heard that clearly. The one thing he said is that in this contract with our new city manager, she will be paying her full portion of her retirement benefits. Now that is something, if you've been following this city council, it's a philosophy we've been moving towards with all of our employee groups. It's something we would like to move towards. Ms. Lyle has decided that she will be step up to the plate and will take this on first. And we appreciate that very much, the leadership ability to do that, to show the rest of our city team and city family that she feels strongly about this too and is the first one to start on. So I appreciate that very much. Can we have a roll call vote, please?
Council members Adams?
Yes.
Shevlin?
Yes.
Spicer?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Garcia?
Yes.
And Mayor Lutz?
Yes. And before we move on to our next item, Ms. Lyle is here, and some of you may have been here at our last meeting when we introduced her, but I want to at least have her stand and be acknowledged, and if she'd like to say something, give her another opportunity.
Thank you, Mayor and City Council. It really is an honor to be able to accept this position and take on this new role with the City of Monrovia. I'm so looking forward to it. I start on April 30th. I've already met with the staff and got an email account set up, so feel free to send me an email if you have an issue with the city.
Oh boy, you've opened your
eyes. I know.
Open it up now.
Absolutely, but I'm very anxious to hear from the residents and see what we can do to continue to improve the city of Monrovia. It's a great place. I'm excited to be here, and I'm happy to say hello to all the new staff members I've met. They've been great. Also happy to meet all the new residents that I've had the opportunity to speak with. They've also been very welcoming, and I'm very appreciative of the reception I've received here. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lori, what is that email address?
I believe it's L. Lyle.
Okay. Thank you.
And she will be starting April 30th, which means she will be here for our very next council meeting that we have. So we welcome you. We're looking forward to your being with us, and we're very excited for the future. Thank you so much. Okay, we'll move on to our next item, which is administrative item on business solid waste and recycling program update. Heather Maloney will give us this report.
Good evening, Mayor Lutz and members of the City Council. Tonight's report will be providing a brief update on the business solid waste and recycling program, specifically to seek direction on how to address a recent vacancy in the program. So on March 20th, the City Council provided additional direction on the business solid waste and recycling program. And then after that, staff proceeded to revise the franchise agreement and release the non-exclusive franchise agreements to the authorized haulers, which are Athens Services, Burtek Waste Services, and Consolidated Disposal Service. Athens and Consolidated have each returned executed agreements to the city. However, on April 6, 2012, the city received a letter from Burtek Waste indicating that they will not be executing a non-exclusive franchise agreement and will not be continuing into the new program. So the Business Solid Waste and Recycling Program currently contains a provision for three non-exclusive solid waste and recycling haulers. Given the recent opening, staff is requesting further direction on how City Council would like to address the vacancy. Currently, the market distribution of the commercial solid waste accounts in the city of Monrovia shows Burtek holding about 5% of the market, which equates to 29 out of the 556 accounts here in the city. So before we get into some of the options that the city has, I do want to review what options Burtek has in transitioning their accounts into the new system. So the first option is that they could sell their routes to the remaining authorized haulers or hauler, or they could sell their routes to another hauler that's not currently authorized to operate in the city. In either of these scenarios, the city's municipal code contains a provision that the city has to authorize that transfer of sale. And the alternate option for Burtek is that they may just wish to have their accounts expire, their current customer agreements expire, and then in that case they would just be notifying their current customers that they would need to sign up with one of the other remaining authorized haulers. So now into the city's options on how to address this vacancy. There are three options the city may consider. The first is to determine if the City Council would like the program to preserve the three hauler positions or be revised to two haulers. If the City Council decides to continue with three openings, the window of time selected for reinstating the vacant spot may be immediately at the end of the initial agreement term, which is in 2016, or at some other time directed by City Council. If the City Council wishes to fill the vacancy immediately, then the invitations to apply for non-exclusive franchises should be issued as soon as possible. Since there is limited time prior to the program start date of July 1, 2012, it may not be possible to solicit the haulers, evaluate proposals, and then execute a contract prior to that July 1 date. It's also worth noting that the two remaining haulers are scheduled to begin their marketing for the new program at the beginning of May. So this would put the new hauler at a significant disadvantage at the get-go of the program. And for this reason, it may be difficult to recruit a hauler into the program at this time. Not impossible, but it may be difficult. In the event that the council chooses to fill the vacancy now, staff seeks council's direction on how you would like us to approach this opening. We have a couple of different options. In the case that Burtek may wish to sell their route to a hauler that's not currently authorized, we could offer an agreement to that hauler to prepare a proposal. We could solicit a specific hauler and ask them to provide a proposal, or we could go through a competitive process and issue invitations to haulers to apply for the program. And then the last option is if City Council selects to keep the opening vacant until the end of the initial franchise term, it would preserve all of your options to consider adding a third hauler at the end of that initial franchise term, as well as we had talked in the past about just leaving all the options open at that point in time. So this would just be another option for consideration at the end of that initial franchise term. So staff's recommendation is option three, and listed in the staff report, which is to keep the third authorized opening vacant until such time that City Council directs to fill this position. And our recommendation is to leave that open until for consideration at the end of that initial franchise term. That concludes my report. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions of staff?
I've got a couple, Heather. If the council decided tonight to just stay with the two, and 2 years from now we felt that for some reason that competition wasn't sufficient. What would the process be to change that, to open it back up?
Sure, that process would be the same as you have now, really. You would have the opportunity to either solicit a specific caller and ask them to deliver a proposal, or you could do more of a competitive process and solicit multiple haulers to join the program at that point in time.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Heather, speaking on what Tom just, on the question he just asked you, if we were to go that way, we might as well have gone with option three to leave the option open, right? To go with the third hauler.
That is, I mean, leaving the vacancy open is one of the options that's available. It's up to council, whether you want to put restrictions on when that can be, revisited, or if you want to leave that open ended. I just want to bring up the point, because you asked, what happens if kind of in between, now and the initial agreement term it expires. There is the possibility that a hauler could approach the city, and then at that time we would need direction on how you'd like to address that. So, if we do select to leave it open ended and not put a specific time frame on that, we should probably discuss how you would like staff to bring that proposal back if that should occur.
Did you have a question?
Well, not so much a question, Heather, but as I remember correctly from when we first looked at this program at the time, didn't we put out that appeal to
other haulers?
The council's direction was to invite the three existing haulers that were operating here, okay, because we had a
strong market. So, in essence, what the council decided was based on the fact that the three existing haulers, which controlled the market share of mm-hmm. business in here, it was like the difference between hiring the majors versus the minors, in my opinion. And I think it would be, disingenuous to even assume that any new hauler that was invited to do that is going to actually have any kind of a level playing field to even compete, for any of that remaining business. I don't know. I would be inclined myself to at this point stay with the two, but that's just my position on it.
Right. So if we were to do the third one, it just keeps that option open. Correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, your three options on that staff has presented to you is to revise the program to just limit it to two haulers only, or you could leave that third vacancy in the program, and then the choice is whether to fill that now or consider filling that at some point in the future.
Heather, have you heard anything from any other hauler indicating an interest in coming into the community?
No, we haven't received any interest or solicitation from any other
So
hauler.
Are you going to need direction from us tonight on how to proceed if somebody does come between now and July 1st?
That's one of the, yes, we do need direction, and that's where if you leave it open-ended, the time frame in which we would consider filling that position, then we would need direction on how you would like staff to proceed, and I can run through some options for you. Alternatively, if you select to just keep that vacant until the end of the initial franchise term, then that would be the direction, and that would be the response to any prospective haulers that would approach the city, and then you'd have the opportunity to evaluate if you would like to fill that position at the end of the initial term.
In the scenario though that Councilman Adams said, if we did that where we kept it vacant until 2016, if by chance there was something that came up and we wanted to fill that third one, we would at that point in time have the option to do that, correct?
Yes, as always, you always have the option to revise the program. That's council's discretion to do that. So it would just require a motion from council.
So if we decided on option number three, which is to kind of leave it open, leave it to the two, but leave it open to at some point that we decide we want a third hauler involved. And between now and July, somebody comes forward and indicates to you that they're interested, run by a scenario by which you feel would be appropriate to handle that.
Well, we would, if that's council's desire for us to bring that forward and evaluate that proposal, we could request that prospective hauler to submit a proposal, just like all the other participating haulers have done, that would, a proposal to fulfill all those requirements, and then we would evaluate if their proposal meets the program requirements. And then at that point in time, we could bring forward a recommendation. If their proposal meets those requirements and if they should be considered to join the program.
Heather, so what you mentioned, though, let's say, for example, the council decided to stick with the two, yet at some point later on they decided for whatever reason that they weren't comfortable with that, they could easily amend that. Is that correct?
That is correct. Yeah, if that's a consideration of yours that you would want to add in another hauler, it's staff's recommendation to leave the three hauler provision in the program. Just choose not to fill the vacancy at this point in time, rather than revising the whole program to say there's only two haulers allowed to participate.
I'm sorry.
In the program.
Say that again, then.
If you're considering to open up a position to a hauler later on, then it would be my recommendation to allow the three haulers, the provision in the program to have three haulers, because that's the way it's written right now, rather and then it would be your opportunity to fill that vacancy whenever council directs.
You have the choice to leave the program as it's written right now, which is has three slots.
Three slots.
Mm-hmm.
But aren't they identified
haulers?
But
only two of those would be filled because the third hauler has decided not to participate.
Okay.
So that's, you'd have one open slot out of three, or change the program and have only two slots. That's the question, that the option that staff is presenting. And the suggestion is that if at some point you feel like competition or some other issue may cause you to think, well, let's go solicit a third hauler, then the suggestion is you should leave it as it is with that third slot in the program, even though there's not a hauler actually in that slot, because some point in the future you may decide to put a hauler in.
So if indeed that happens, though, and that still leaves the ability for the two remaining haulers to compete for the
29
other balance of the
correct
positions.
Correct. Correct.
They could do so.
Right. We'd be moving forward with two operating businesses going forward, and then basically they would then be taking over the business of the one hauler who's leaving.
Okay.
Is he leaving as of the July 1?
As of June 30th.
June 30th?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So after June 30th, they just leave, and then those people would then have to then choose between one of the two continuing businesses. That's how it would operate until the council came back and felt maybe it was time to fill that third vacancy with a new hauler, and then that new hauler then has to try to go get some of the market share.
And that would be solely at our discretion.
Correct.
So even if another hauler came in and asked for the opportunity, it would solely be our discretion to say whether we would or would not want to do that at that time.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Option three leaves the council with the most flexibility to whether to just to stay with the two, or at some point you want to add a third one in, you can do that.
So it sounds like in either case, it's up to us, but one would be quicker than the other.
Correct.
Right. So if we go with option three and we wanted to bring in a third company, we could do it very quickly. And if we go with option two, we would have to come back and alter the program and then go get the third company.
That's correct.
So what's that time difference? Is it 1 month, 2 months, 3 months?
It's an extra city council meeting and an extra city council action, I guess, to put it that way. So
a month?
Or 2 to 4 weeks.
Doesn't sound like it's a whole lot of difference, honestly.
Except I think one locks us in for a time period and the other...
2 weeks?
Is it? Yeah. Do we have any consensus here?
So if we do the three, it just, everything's, you don't have to revise anything, it just stays the same, we just leave it that one...
Vacancy.
Vacant.
And I mean, what are we having to redo or revamp if we do the two?
You would be revising the program provisions.
Other than just the language. I mean, you're talking verbiage of two versus three.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So it's only like one paragraph you're changing?
But that would require the same process that we would go through, correct? Let's say we gave you the direction of doing option number two. So we want to revise it to have only two haulers. Mm-hmm. Give us a scenario of what you do now with that.
There's actually nothing further required.
Nothing further. You just revise it and we file the new one.
So mm-hmm. we don't have to have you come back to us for another approval in 2 weeks.
No, if you want to revise the program to just have two haulers for here on out, then to my understanding, it would just be your action on record that would revise that program.
Okay.
And if we wanted to, we could change it if we want.
At any point in time that we see fit, we could say, you know what, we really need to go back to our original idea of three.
I think more than anything else, it might be helpful to look at it as kind of a statement of preference. If you have a program that provides for two haulers, and you have two haulers in that slot, you're basically saying to the regulated community, we've got what we want, and this is the program we're comfortable with till 2016. If you want to come in, you'd have to change our minds about that preference. Whereas if you stick with option three and you have three slots but two haulers, basically the statement to the hauling community is, if somebody wants to come in and try to take a piece of this business, we're open to that. We have a slot for it.
I think
more than anything else, it's just a sort of a policy statement or a preference statement. It's not really.
And I know it may seem like semantics, Craig, but I feel like we addressed that issue at the last thing in terms of the direction that we were essentially by the three haulers.
Right.
No one has dropped off.
So I mean, that again, I get that notion. It's like the three major league teams versus. You know, just throwing it out open again. I'm more compelled to just say, you know, let's stay with the two and then see what happens, and then ultimately, I'm going to take a real crazy shot at this, and I'm gonna move that we revise the existing business solid waste and recycling program to allow only two authorized, non-exclusive franchise haulers to fill. And that's it.
Can I make one comment on that?
Sure.
Just for clarification, what you just said about what was the direction the last time we talked, and the council's direction was to go forward with three haulers.
Right.
Option three still says the council's direction was three. One of them just dropped out, so council still was going forward with three, but we're just operating with two right now.
I understand, the assumption is that we had new franchise agreements that were not going to be affected by the choice of haulers.
Correct.
That we were doing.
Correct.
That we were going to affect the fact that each individual hauler had their market share of people.
Correct.
We didn't want to change that.
Correct.
And that was what I thought we had agreed upon.
Well, and that's not changing.
Okay. Well.
Right.
No. The only reason the market share, let me go back here. These are the three options that Burtek has at hand to address, to transition their accounts. They could sell it to one of the existing haulers, or they could split up their route and sell off portions of it to the two existing haulers. Again, they could just dissolve those contracts, and then those customers could choose.
So if we went with the two, Heather, and they decided to sell off, they couldn't sell it outside of the those two haulers.
Exactly.
So you're
limiting your Vertex choices.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Mr. Garcia, are you still comfortable with your motion? Because we need a second if it's going to move further.
Yes.
Okay. I'll second.
Is there any further discussion? I'd like to say I'm sorry the Vertex has decided not to continue with us. I think that this council was comfortable with the three haulers that we were working with, and I'm sorry that they've decided not to be part of the program, and I wish them well. And with that, we'll have all in favor.
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Thank you, Heather.
Thank you.
Thank you, Heather.
Thank you, Heather.
Thank you.
Our next item is the Business Development Assistance Agreement with Sierra Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram. And Darlene Sanchez will give us the staff report.
Good evening, Mayor Lutz and council members. Under my report tonight, I will be discussing the details of the proposed Business Development Assistance Agreement between the city and RDJC LLC, doing business as Sierra Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram. The agreement is a sales tax sharing and operating covenant for a new car dealership that will be located at 1305 South Mountain Avenue. The site on Mountain Avenue has had a very productive past, including Lincoln, Saturn, and Mazda dealerships, and was originally assembled by the former redevelopment agency in the late 1980s as part of Monrovia's Auto Center. Yet for almost 6 years, the site has been mostly vacant, used as a seasonal holiday store or as overflow storage for the neighboring dealership. Although a prime location off of the freeway, the site has some limitations as it is built. And in December 2011, the ownership began discussions with city staff on bringing in a renovated auto dealership concept that would carry Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, and Ram models. However, because of Chrysler Corporation's high standards for the dealership, extensive tenant improvements will be required to be made to that building. After considering various options, the city and the ownership determined that a partnership through a business development assistance program or agreement would be mutually beneficial deal that could get the site developed to the highest and best use, rather than pay any upfront costs typical of most business development assistance agreements, it would be structured as a tax sharing covenant. Under the proposed terms of the agreement, a maximum amount of $750,000 would be paid to the ownership for the necessary tenant improvements. All funds would be paid from 50% of the sales tax that is generated from the site. Payments would be made by the city up to the amount of the actual tenant improvements, but not at an amount to exceed $750,000, as long as the business remains operational as a Chrysler auto dealership. In this very challenging economic climate, a new car dealership is a fortunate and opportune economic development prospect. Through the approval of this agreement, not only is the site returned to a productive use and returned to that use sooner than later, the Chrysler dealership will also provide new jobs to replace the nearly 50 jobs that were lost at the site, as well as substantial sales tax revenue that is expected to be generated here. Staff recommends approval of the agreement. That concludes my report, and I can answer any questions that you might have.
Any questions of staff?
I do have a question, actually, and a concern, although I understand part of our duty to help business move forward, particularly in California, because Sacramento seems to do everything they can to hurt business. But I guess my concern is that we're paying this money out of new money. And I know I've had a conversation with Mark about this. And to me, there's two things here. There's branding and there's new money. And a classic example is if someone decided to not buy a Chevy from Sierra, but bought a Chrysler instead, there's maybe no new money that comes to Monrovia. Yet by that change in branding, we would be responsible to pay funds to the dealership. And my question is, could we look at the overall level of sales to ensure that before we give the people's money away, that it's new money to us? because I'm afraid if we don't do that, what we may just end up doing is just giving away money without having the benefit of new money being generated. And again, that's new money without without any concern over what brand is on it. But is it truly new money coming in? And it kind of makes sense to me, but I want to see if there's something we can do to adjust this for that.
That is something that staff can look at with this company that has existing dealerships in town already, right, and existing business going on. If that is the council's pleasure, we can go back to the applicant and talk about looking at existing business and making sure that we're increasing business.
I'm just afraid if the way this is set up, if I understand it correctly, we may end up spending $75,000 a year that really didn't generate any new funds to the city. Based on Peter's got his hand up. I don't know if that's appropriate or not, but I don't know.
I will give you some time to speak in a moment. So be ready to answer that question.
That is something that staff, if councils would like to do that is something we would go back and talk to the applicant about possibly working in looking at. If I'm understanding correctly, Mr. Adams' suggestion is looking at the existing business and making sure that with this new business coming in, where the new business is generating new business over the existing business that is still there.
And speaking to that point, if this agreement is with the RDJC LLC, which I believe means Ram, Dodge, Jeep, Chrysler, that indicates to me that this is a separate business or a separate sub-business of Sierra Auto Cars. Am I correct?
That is correct. The Chrysler operation is licensed as and run by a separate LLC, so it is a completely, separate business.
If it's separate, then would we not be receiving money, tax money, from this separate entity that this agreement is with? It already is separated out, is it not?
It depends on how many vehicles, right?
Yes.
What I'm saying is don't separate it.
See, now I'm confused.
If Sierra generates $10 million in sales overall in Monrovia this year, and if next year Sierra generates $10 million in sales overall in Monrovia, we haven't made any new money. All we've done is people have changed brands. And what I would hope that we can do is make sure that before we write a check for $75,000, that Monrovia got some new money, not just brand changed money.
He's saying that new sales would be over and above what we're already getting.
Correct.
From the current sales.
Because if it's not new money, then why are we paying for it?
Okay, I think I understand.
We're hoping then that auto sales go up.
Well, not just that auto sales go up, but that this facility
right.
brings in new
right.
business.
Right.
Truly new business.
Does anybody else have any other questions? I'll let Mr.
Just
Hoffman speak.
Quick question, Darlene. You pointed out background-wise that the original site actually generated an average of $125,000 in sales tax per year. Is that an estimate of what this potential new business would
actually generate? We're looking at a little bit more. The industry is actually currently in a growth mode, and you know, part of this is, you know, the Hoffmans, which own the dealership, they've been in the automobile dealership for some time, so you know, their interest is not in general taking away funds from the other. And I'm sure Mr. Hoffman may speak to that, but Chrysler did do a market study of the general area. There's 15 Chrysler dealerships in Southern California, only three of which are in the San Gabriel Valley. They're in Puente Hills, Alhambra, and Glendora. So they specifically picked Monrovia for a reason. There was a void currently in that market. And so the projected sales for this particular site is from anywhere from $150,000 to $250,000 a year.
Okay, any other questions before I bring Mr. Hoffman up?
No.
Okay, Mr. Hoffman, would you like to address us?
Hello, I'm Peter Hoffman, president of Sierra Auto Cars and RDJC LLC. And I live at 539 North Alta Vista in Monrovia.
Got it all covered.
I
got
it covered. For a long time.
You raise a great point, Tom. And if it were, I think, separate, truly separate, I think it would be more of a thing. But what we would never, I mean, if that ends up being the circumstance that we steal business from ourselves in order to get reimbursed for money that we've already spent, we're kind of stupid. Or at least we made a mistake. And I really doubt that that's going to happen. Right now, there's quite a few of the Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, Ram products that are being sold in our area. I track them by a cross sell every month to sort of see what's going on. And our intent is to steal that business and grow that business. I think the calculation you want to do will be very difficult. I mean, initially, staff was kind of pleased that it was going to be a separate entity so that they could actually measure what that entity is doing. If you look at, there's a possibility that something bad will happen to Chevrolet, for example, and that their sales will drop, and in that case, and maybe Chrysler will pick up some lost sales from there. But it's going to be more of a market condition kind of thing than simply because that store is located mm-hmm. nearby. And if it's not located there, it's going to get located someplace else. So one way or the other, it's going to be business captured by Monrovia, even if it does steal it from Chevrolet. But I think there'll be a little bit of that, but I suspect there'll be more of the other, that the synergy of having them adjacent to each other will make sure that probably both sell more, mm-hmm. and whichever wins, Monrovia wins.
Well, and I think we all want you to be successful, but if what you just said happens, then there's really no loss in doing it that way. Because if one doesn't cannibalize the other, then you haven't lost anything by putting that safeguard in. But I feel more comfortable looking at Monrovia's purse and making sure that there's just a little extra protection in there.
I guess the question is, how do you measure
money?
How do you measure whether it's a matter of Chevrolet or Honda or Mazda or Subaru, or BMW for that matter, losing business because of market conditions versus because of adjacent competition?
Well, I thought maybe it wouldn't be fair to throw BMW into the mix because it's not your company. I thought the Sierra brands might be fair to look at the total number.
Yeah, that would. But how do you judge it? Is the question? I mean,
well, you probably know what your sales are.
Well, no, we do, and so do you. But we don't know. I mean, it's going to be a question. I mean, look, Toyota a couple of years ago had some problems, and their sales were diminished.
Right.
Last year, Honda had a tsunami, a nuclear meltdown, a flood in Thailand, and a lot of things that diminished their sales that had nothing to do with whether or not there was an adjacent store that was more competitive. In reality, I think for Monrovia, Subaru picked up some business. Mazda picked up some business because they were further south in Japan mm-hmm. and were able to maintain production a little better. And certainly Chevrolet profited from, with the Cruze and like that, from some of the shortages at Honda. But this year, we expect to see a rebound the other way. How do you factor in all those global factors in comparing whether or not Sierra...
You probably can't control those and we can't, but one thing's for certain, if we don't get new money into Monrovia as a result of this action, then any money we give you is just gifting public funds to you, because it has to be new money for us to share in that. And so how do you calculate new money? You got to look at the bigger picture, I think.
Okay, I just don't know if you'll know. from whatever that analysis is, it's going to be difficult to try to figure out. Probably, I believe the cleanest way to do it is to look at this competing entity, which is going to compete with Ford and Duarte as well.
Mm-hmm.
And
we want you to.
And where it draws business from is going to be very difficult to tell. But I'll tell you, the people working at that store, other than me, are all going to do everything they can to beat Chevrolet. And Chevrolet is going to do everything they can to beat them.
I know they will.
And
all we want is for the total of all of that to go up.
And, you know, the other factors, it almost certainly will. We're coming out of a pretty dramatic low
in I'm sure you'll be fine.
New car sales. I hope so. But whatever, however fine we are, you're finer.
I understand.
Mr. Hoffman, Darlene mentioned some of the what she anticipated the growth of the sales anticipation dollars will be. Is that an accurate portrayal of what you anticipate that business will be?
Yeah, it was what we're hoping for. It's, you know, frankly, it's a fairly small site to stuff four significant franchises into, and we're kind of lucky that Chrysler decided to go with us on that. And it's going to be a new experience for that facility to have that strong a franchise and a few of them. So I anticipate pretty good things for all of us out of this.
I have a question. Peter, overall on your other Sierra businesses, times have been tough for the auto industry. What has been your sales over, say, the last 5 years? Has it been an upward trend or up and down or?
Well, the state of California in 2007 sold over 2 million new cars. In 2009, they sold just a touch over 1 million new cars. It's been a little bit of a tough slog for the last few years. For whatever it's worth, we have been profitable through that entire stretch. But our new car volumes diminished significantly, and in the last year, we had other factors at play with particularly Honda and Subaru in the last year that kept their volume from growing like it was. In the first quarter, we were on a pretty good thing, and then March 11th changed things for a while, and we really didn't get back to full. Actually, we're not back to full inventories yet with Honda. But we started to get reasonable supplies and where it was flowing in the right direction in February. So we haven't seen a full rebound on that. But this is going to be an interesting year in terms of competition in the car business. Every year is an interesting year, I guess. But
especially in California.
Yeah, well, California, for the things that you mentioned earlier, is even more interesting.
Peter, I'm curious. I know historically the dealerships that you've had there have been there now for, I believe, what, 15, 17, 18 years?
23.
23?
Yeah, I was going to say much longer.
And I guess I look at it from a standpoint because I know that, you know, back then we had different tools. The council had and the city had different tools in their quiver here to work with, you know, helping businesses. You know, tax sharing agreements not being one of them is just basically something new that cities are having to look at now that we don't have redevelopment, you know, at our disposal anymore. And I really think the fact that there is even an opportunity to bring business during these economic times is still a win-win for Monrovia. You know, I recognize that somehow somebody could maybe interpret that this is anything but truly a tax sharing agreement, and that is indeed what it is that we're partnering in order to ultimately continue to boost our economic engine here in terms of our sales tax using different tools that we have. And I guess that's how I'm trying to get my head around that, you know, as opposed to whatever perceptions there may be about, you know, other avenues that say, you know, we're gifting public funds or we're doing anything like that. I don't truly believe that's the case. I honestly think that this is potentially a win-win for you know, our community and that.
Well, and that's why we're all doing it. You know, we're advancing the funds, and then we get back up to $750,000 of what we've spent by sharing 50% of tax revenues that are new. And Mr. Adams is completely right that if they're not new, then it's it looks more like you're helping to subsidize our failed effort, which
so what can we do?
We want to make the effort.
What can we do to give us more assurance that we won't be just giving you money that wasn't new generated funds?
I don't know.
It's the only idea I could come up with was mine.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Just kind of talking about what you're saying. I'm asking Peter about what's been his activity the last couple years and stuff.
Right.
Maybe we can do is go back and look at the last, you know, 3 or 4 years, last, you know, 4 or 5 years, and kind of take an average of what his operations have done, and kind of get a feel for where that's at, and then if we're comfortable with if you're looking at that, is that can be kind of a base, and we can maybe use that as a benchmark, and we can just try to keep on top of this very, very closely and see if it's, I mean, if we're dropping below that.
I just want to make sure that if we're revenue sharing, it's new revenue. I don't want to give you last year's dollars. And I'm sure you can appreciate that as a businessman, that I'm all about sharing the new stuff. And if this is what it takes to create the new stuff, then we should share with you. But if there's no new money, then why would we? And I know I'm certain positive it will be new money. And
well,
I just want to have that same assurance.
It's going to be new money one way or another. And as you say, we may be stealing a Chevrolet sale, and that would be because something happens to Chevrolet in the marketplace. You know, and I don't know what that would be, but you can go back to, you know, the 60s or 70s or whatever it was when Audi had sudden acceleration. It destroyed the franchise. It wasn't true even, but it still destroyed the franchise.
Right.
And that could happen to Chevrolet, in which case, where would Monrovia have been in the you know, the effort to generate sales tax? Well, Chevrolet would have gone way down, and they would have had nothing backing it up.
Mm-hmm.
Distinguishing that from what I don't see is happening is where suddenly they decide to buy Ram trucks over Silverados. I think both consuming populations are relatively loyal to their brands. And the effort to win one from the other is causes about equal migration. I think I don't see that really happening.
You know, I
don't know how to measure it either.
I agree with Mr. Garcia and his comments regarding the tools and the tools that are left to us. And quite frankly, the state of California has really left us with not a lot of options in how we can assist businesses, either current businesses or new businesses coming in. And I really am happy to see our staff come up with some of these new tools and ways that we can do this. What I'm wondering is, if this was not Mr. Hoffman standing in front of us from Sierra Auto Cars, who is an existing business, but a new business that we were enticing, we wouldn't be having this discussion at all. And so in
actually,
a sense,
I think we would.
Well, it would be all new money. Your point about new money would be new money from from a brand new person, new company.
If Lowe's wanted to move right in next door to Home Depot, chances are we would be trading dollars based on branding, not on new revenue. if we wanted to bring one restaurant in right next door to another restaurant, chances are there's going to be a certain amount of cannibalization going on. And all I'm suggesting is, before we write a check of public funds to a private business that we're certain, as certain as we can be, that this is truly new money. That's
all. Well, Tom, one of the things that, I mean, we did have those conversations back with Home Depot and some of the hardware stores and lumber yards that were in town. And part of the answer there was, if Monrovia didn't keep it in Monrovia's borders, it was going to end up in Duarte's. Or Arcadia's,
that.
And you're going to lose that business anyway. They were going to go away. It's just going to lose it to another city.
I fully understand that, and I was 100% in favor of that. What I'm saying is, if you were to park a Lowe's right next door to a Home Depot, that doesn't mean that the number of people buying roofing material doubles. What it means is maybe somebody's switching stores. That's all.
Mr. Hoffman, the concept of auto malls, auto dealerships in a concentrated area, the reason that is preferable for auto dealerships is why?
Well, you get that it's clear to people that there's a bunch of auto dealers over there, and they go looking for the product that they're going. There is some cross-shopping that's there, but mostly it's that there's kind of a destination that people know that there's a bunch of dealerships, and so what they're looking for is probably going to be there. For us, it's more efficient to advertise with one location that we're trying to draw people from, or two from, or four, a bunch of different franchises. I'm preposition challenged here. There are some real benefits. But also getting them located around other retail centers like Walmart and Home Depot, Best Buy, all those things helps. I mean, that synergizes as well. So there are some strong positives. And just as an aside, Chevrolet is spending more money than you can imagine in product development and advertising and other things. And they've got a great product line. And
I know they
it
do.
Seems
I just wish
it
I could
seems
fit in on
that it might probably maybe it can go the other way. I mean, there's some really good stuff coming down the line from Chevrolet. I don't think they're going to be compromised by this.
And I doubt that they will either. And I'm surprised at anyone's reluctance to put that assurance in writing.
Well, Marianne, I agree with you. It's not someone that hasn't had a business in this community. You know, I understand what Tom is talking about as far as new money and stuff, but this corner has been sitting empty for so long, and it's not just because it's an eyesore, but if someone's going to come in and put some people to work and upgrade that corner, I think we have to give it a shot. I really believe so. It's not like it's someone new that's coming from out of town into the city trying to bring a business. Someone that's been, you know, plus he's a local. He's a Monrovian, you know? So,
it's a vote for Peter.
I think we need to do what's best.
Are you making a motion?
What would the motion be? Oh, okay. I make a motion we approve the business development assistance agreement with RDJC LLC for the property located at 1305 South Mountain Avenue. Okay. Did I read it right? Oh, and authorize the city manager to execute the necessary documents.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
I'll be opposed, and I just, Pete, you know, we've known each other for a long time. This has nothing to do with you or your family. Your generosity in Monrovia stands above most. I just don't feel that we've done an adequate job of protecting the public funds on this, but we wish you nothing but success.
Thank you. This motion carries. Thank you. This concludes our city council meeting for this evening, and our next council meeting will be Tuesday, May 1st, May Day, here in this very chambers at 7:30. And until then, we are adjourned.
Alice, I was watching you again.